It's a honor and a pleasure to be here, and I think I want to say a couple of things first before I read poems. And I just want to say something that you all probably know, which is this is a very important thing, the loft. Anything that promotes books and reading. We are in a moment right now of probably great confusion. And I think one of the things that art and literature can do is teach us how to be inside that confusion and what to do with that confusion. And I feel like one of the things that poems teach me is that confusion is often a preface to awe and to astonishment. And poems engage our imagination such that the confusion is not the end point, right? This moment of bewilderment is an opportunity for our imagination now. It's an opportunity for us to imagine ourselves into the future. There's so many poets who can teach us how to do that. I've had so many different feelings being here so soon after the election. Incredible sadness, incredible fear, incredible affection from so many and toward so many people. I feel very, very lucky to be among a lot of talented people and to witness a community that cares about the education of the imagination. If anything has failed us in the last 25 years since I started writing seriously, it's been that mistrust of the imagination. And I hope that we can reinvigorate that through our own poems. I hope we can follow the music. So I want to thank the Loft for making a space for that. Several years ago, on my Fulbright, I didn't have a full-time job. I had a little storage space where I put everything that I owned. And because I was in the Philippines and I didn't have a whole lot of money, I lost everything that was in the storage space. I was too ashamed to ask anybody for any help, so I lost everything. The last thing. Or song for when they take it all away. They take the books, the crates of 80s 12-inch singles, a few dozen letters from Manila, LA, Seville. They take my stinky trash can and cracked plastic chair, the rickety plywood shelves, 11 photos of my mother, leaving me with one. They take the dim shots of my brother's young faces beside mine. They take away the clean sheets folded among the soiled ones, the hand towels stained with fevers and shit, and official notices of all my debt stuffed in a box with three dead flies. Oh, and the tangled brush of a woman whom I loved for one whole week, which, remembering her, makes me lift my hand as if to propose half a prayer or to illustrate the best way to answer a deaf king is to drop a fist on a heavy table in place of blasphemy's last syllable. They take it all from a cold, rented 5-foot space, and when I can't pay, they cross out my name, double shackle the gate, fill every proper form and price the pitiful lot for the block. They call me to cough up over and over, say, explain yourself. Shame is like you're made of 10,000 beautiful doors, and every day you try to keep them all from flying open at once. They reach inside and take the boxes of shoes and old shirts, the third hand scratched up oak desk I heaved up 20 steps overlooking West Grand Ave. With their battalion of metallic hands, they'll take away silence, they'll take away touch, they'll take music too, which is when I'll stand up alone and walk toward you and offer a few fingers for you to lead me to an empty floor and sway. They'll take the light, they'll confiscate my teeth and leave the knives with no handles. They take it all away. They take away weeping and take away laughter. Not last to go are the goats, as if I could forget the curses. And ha ha, they'll take my eyes and they won't even eat them. They have taken so much. I am standing now somewhere at the end of a road which leads to a beach beside a sea that a million ghosts keep crossing, leaving everything I once had, everything I've become, everything electric in a muscle to make one minuscule move again toward the beautiful, in that wacky wandering, in that bloody path, in that smoky inventory of a quarter century, in that ambling, in that sprint toward every gorgeous living thing, no matter how tortured or peaceful I'm going. I am almost completely gone. I am stepping away. Watch me as I leave the forks. I leave the hammers. I leave the bones. I am left with love. I leave the boiled coins, the thin shells of swans. I am left with love. I leave the latches and bolts open. I am left again and again with love. I leave and I leave and I am left again and again, and I can't seem to shake it. The rage leaves me again and again. And love is left. It is all that is ever left. And today, I am blessed. I am the last thing burning. Hello. At the tribunals. Parece que se cae, pero no se cae. Parece que se cae, pero no se cae. Parece que se cae, pero no se cae. Once, in a brawl on Orchard, I clocked a kid with a ridge hand so hard I could feel his top teeth give. His knees buckled and my homeboy let loose a 1-2 to finish the job. I turned around to block a sucker punch that didn't come. We ducked under the cop's bright red hatchets that swung around the corner. I never saw the first kid drop. He must have been still falling when I dipped from the scene and trotted toward Delancey. He was falling when I stopped to check my leather for scuff marks. He was falling when I slipped inside a dive to hide from a girl who got ghost for books. He was falling when I kissed the Santo Niño's white feet and Melanie's left collarbone and the forehead of one punk whose nose I busted for nothing but squaring off with me. His head snapped back to show his neck's smooth pelt look away long enough. And a boy can fall for weeks, decades, even as you get down on one knee to pray the rotting kidneys in your mom's gut don't turn too quick to stone. I didn't stick around to watch my own work. I didn't wait for a single body to hit the pavement. In those days, it was always spring, and I was always made of knives. I rolled 22 deep, every one of us lulled by a blade, though few of us knew the steel note that chimed a full measure if you slid the edge along around to make it keen. I'll tell those stiffs in frocks to go ahead and count me among the ones who made nothing good with his bare hands. I'll confess, I love the wreckage, no matter the country, no matter the machine. Parece que se cae, pero no se cae. Parece que se cae, pero no se cae. Parece que se cae, pero no se. Making love to you the night they take your father to prison. There's got to be a chorus somewhere for the conjunction of honeysuckle and funk. A verse for the turn of your hips and the sling back steel bar anthem banged out breathless over your father's small time underhand hustle. A tune that begins in the skin's hi-hat quiver begins with a lick of the fist or the thrum of a summer gust doubled in the brief sweet moan coaxed from your mouth and mine. We grind slow. Two bodies become one small song, scarcely loud enough to budge God and any three of his bloody saints. Baby, we are our own wine. We improvise the gorgeous toil, stillness, and motion against each other make. Bone on blunt bone, gleefully barbaric, call it blessed. We cull something like salt out of the seep of evening air, immense and rising like incense, so stink, hellfire must work twice as hard to burn it into us, and then once again, back out. By dawn, you'll leave my finger between your teeth, and behind it, the last grief of the first man you've ever adored on the verge of free. Sometimes the body in music unlocks its most ruthless interrogatives. And to this and the rest of the world tonight, I cannot stop saying yes. Any Bill Withers fans in here? All right, that's cool. I was writing this book. I was engaged for a couple of years, and it just didn't work out. And goddamn, that fucked me up. My response to grief has often been to dance. So, broke heart, just like that. When the bass drops on Bill Withers' Better Off Dead, it's like 7 a.m. And I confess, I'm looking over my shoulder once or twice just to make sure no one in Brooklyn is peeking into my third floor window to see me in pajamas I haven't washed for 3 weeks before I slide from sink to stove in one long groove, left foot first and back to the window side with my chin up and both fists clenched like two small sacks of stolen nickels. And I can almost hear the silver hit the floor by the dozens when I let loose and sway a little back. And just like that, I'm a lizard grown two new good legs on a breeze bent limb. I'm a grown ass man with a 3-day wish and 2 days to live. And just like that, everyone knows my heart's broke and no one is home. Just like that, I'm water. Just like that, I'm the boat. Just like that, I'm both things in the whole world rocking. Sometimes sadness is just what comes between the dancing. And bam, my mother's dead. And bam, my brother's children are laughing. just like I can't pop up from my knees so quick these days. And no one ever said I could sing, but tell me my body ain't good enough for this. I'll count the aches right now, one in each ankle, the sharp spike in my back, this mud muscle throbbing in my going bones. I'm missing the six biggest screws to hold this blessed mess together. I'm wind-rattled, the wood splitting, the hinges are falling off. When the first bridge ends, just like that, I'm a flung open. So this poem, it's loosely based on a place in the Philippines called Culion, which is, during the American occupation, it was the biggest leper colony in the world. Now it's a travel resort. Instance of an island. God, I'm reading fast. I'm gonna be done in like 5 minutes, man. Instance of an island. One way to erase an island is to invent a second island absolved of all the sounds the first one ever made. We don't know who concocted this one, where the triggerfish and clowns fade to inky neon dashes under a fisherman's skiff. A few plastic pontoons knock around makeshift slips. Dusk coaxes from the shore the small, dull chime of a spoon against a pot, and TV voices flash slow across a cliff. Two pink lovers in matching swimwear kiss their glasses at the edge of a blue pool built just low enough into the hill so the couple can gaze into the sea and think of infinity. Many, many years ago, a great emperor wiggled his finger and commanded his army to corral all the lepers in his domain, then pack them into a sailing ship to be delivered to the missions on this cluster of verdant volcanic rock. The emperor's orders to his captain were clear. If the monks refused the ship's freight, the skipper was to simply dump the whole sick cargo far from any shore. Other incurables followed in lots over time, or trickled in, hiding from nearby tribes, or banished from lands to live among these lush slopes of mahogany, papaya, and weeds. Two women, Filomena and Josefa, arrived within days of one another. By then, each had lost most of their toes, though they had 10 full fingers between them, each woman with one hand still intact. No one is sure how it began, but once a week, the pair would knock on the door of the scowling Madre Clementina to borrow the hospital's only guitar, carved from jackfruit and cracked pretty bad along the back. To these women, no big deal, for Filomena once transcribed the early moonlight serenades of the horny friars in the royal south for the brats of an Andalusian duke. Josefa was a daughter of a carpenter, a maker of tables to be exact. She learned to play Ajarana's tremulous melodies on her mother's banduria at the age of 3. The pair of outcasts would stifle laughs, thrilled to earn the crusty nun's grudging yes, then amble out to low tide and find a flat rock to share so they could prop the old guitar on both their laps. The one bad wrist of each woman unwrapped to their stumps, pulled for now behind their backs as they look past the bay toward the violent waters that first carried them here, and they jammed. Filomena, with the 5 deft hammers of her left, and Josefa with her right, thick-muscled, both blue-veined and furious, scrubbing from the instrument all those wicked rhythms from Castile to nowhere on a fragile scrap of furniture that could barely hold its tune. They sat shoulder to shoulder and thigh to thigh, their good hands brushing from time to time. What they couldn't remember, they made up, and everything they made up disappeared past the lagoon and over the ocean. Every note and every run, every lie and desire, every nick and crack in the jackfruit, the fat harmonies plucked from the old nun's grunts, six taut strands of gut whose cords skimmed the water like night locusts and bursts of low clouds, and which bore everything in front of them and behind. The brine of the women's necks mixed with the salt of the lagoon, the cliffs, the spoons, the bright nimbus of the west dipping like a noose, the future of pontoons and fake tits, the history of nifty crowns pried loose of their jewels, the jiggle of a little finger gone still. One way to erase an island is to invent the waters that surround it. You can name the waters which will turn all the sounds the island makes to salt. It will teach you to listen to everything you love disappear. Or you can invent a song so big it will hold an entire ocean. Josefa and Filomena rocked in the dark, hip to hip, joined by that third body of wood, which made sure there was nothing left in the unbroken world to possibly make them whole. I'm going to read, I think I'm just going to read two more. Should I keep going? Shit. Man, so I just want to tell a quick story. I hadn't seen my father in about 4 years. He moved from New Jersey out to Henderson, Nevada, just outside of Las Vegas, about 5 or 6 years ago. And I went to visit him once in the first couple of years he was out there, and then I haven't seen him. I've been spending a lot of time out in LA, and he turned 88 2 weeks ago, 88 years old. I said, you know, this is not a man that I've had a very good relationship with, but I said, you know, let me go out. I'm gonna surprise him on his birthday. So I got a flight like 3 days before his birthday, and I just showed up at his front door. Yeah, my dad's not the weeping type, you know. But I showed up at the front door and he was crying. He's like, oh my God, this is the best birthday gift. And it was sort of amazing. We, you know, did a lot of storytelling that first day or two. And it didn't end well, you know. It wasn't how I planned it. My father and I have been through all kinds of things, and I've worked at reconciliation with him for a long, long time. And some things just don't go away between a father and a son. Back in, 2001 or two, 2003 or 2004, I went to Argentina for a month because I was broke-hearted again, and I was trying to forget. And I rented an apartment down in Buenos Aires, and we grew up only speaking English. Spanish is my second language. I speak a couple other languages, of Filipino, fairly well, but Spanish is really my second language. My father speaks Spanish fluently too, but we only exclusively spoke English at home. Anyway, when I got to Argentina, I was a few days in my apartment, and I said, you know what, maybe I should just call him to let him know I'm okay down here. And so I called him up, and I started speaking to him. I greeted him in Spanish. And then he greeted me back in Spanish. And then we had this whole conversation in Spanish. It was the first time ever. And it was like the most pleasant thing. And I realized that it was partially because we had never been angry at one another in that language. You know, we hung up that phone. It was like, holy shit, that's a good dude. I don't know when I'll talk to my father again, but I just want to call him into the room. So this poem is about that phone call. As glass. When the sons of Buenos Aires holler in chorus from the muck-blessed soccer field across the street, they're calling to me in the formal idioms their fathers use to ignore the ubiquitous feral dogs and the beggars of Recoleta. I understand just enough to fling back halfway to the park's paved border their summer-toughened leather ball and return to my hard-floor Palermo flat to phone my dad back in Jersey. Papa, I say, tu hijo habla. Of course, at first, he doesn't recognize my voice or even his own name, for I am speaking to him with an affection whose prepositions point in all the wrong directions. But for 6 full minutes, we are unfamiliar with one another's rage. For once, we are laughing at the same time. It's simple. We don't loathe one another in Spanish like we do in English, a language I've long known for its fluid burn, the way it rises from my father's ankles into his belly, from his torso into his limbs like molten glass. This is why he and I can glare at one another for decades without moving. All the lexicons of sadness and delight turning cold and hard about every muscle and bone, twisting around the capillaries, flooding the metacarpal nooks, stopping in the esophagus, so if flesh, sinew, and gut, this human crucible were to fall away as it must, what's left is the clear anatomy of a man cast in a language gone 77 years unsummoned. The whittled wooden fans of his childhood, his mother's calesa rocking over vegan cobblestone, a whore's warm breast flushed against him like a good bottle of rum, cracked cathedral windows, some cots and soup, and all 400 years of horseshit poured hot through his veins, and I am there too, sitting in a chilly apartment in Palermo, listening to the fading howls from the football field, the bold charity of a foreign tongue sweetening the image in my mind of this quickly aging man who whacked me and my brothers silly with his leather belt. And down the street, I can still hear those boys teasing one another in Lunfardo. Maybe they're not too young to despise their fathers. Maybe they can already taste in the prayers they pretend to say before they sleep, that petty venom distilling in their mouths. But not today, not in this Castilian. For today, this speech of imperial thieves, this dialect of conquerors, this larcenist's parlance, I'm taking back as my own. In every word of every tenderness I have failed to speak is already rising through my knees as glass. It is ancient and it is pure. It is not free of bitterness or grief. It is heating my very fingers as I write this. I want to learn to love more fluently, even if it means in English, I should shatter into the body of my father. I'm going to finish. We were all going around the table today. It was really great. Everybody was talking about what they're working on, and I'm working on a collection of new and selected love poems. So I want to finish with this one. It's for my girlfriend, Carissa Chen, who's been incredible, who has taught me kindness and gentleness and intelligence that I couldn't nearly have approached without her. So I'm very grateful to her. And so it's for her. She lives in Guttenberg, New Jersey, which is, if you're around, let me think, probably around 119th Street on the west side of Manhattan, and you look across the Hudson River, up on that hill over there, you'll see a little town called Guttenberg, and that's where she grew up, and her folks still have a place up there. Thank you all for coming. Congrats again to all the finalists and to the McKnight Fellows. Making out in Guttenberg, New Jersey. For Carissa Chen. Above the boulevards of sweat, where the kids are gathering again at the back of a public bus to plan the resurrection of laughter. An old woman on a bench slides both pink shoes off her feet in the middle of spring so she can sit a while longer and look at the same river as us. For a little extra heat, she rubs her hands together so vigorously, the jays all leap at once, and I could stop the sun right now. I could be wicked as a fruit thief. I could touch your middle knuckle with my thumb and pretend I don't know all your names. But the cherry blossoms are just coming into view. From the heights, old men secretly wish to leap into their creamy bloom. Logic tells them, patience, friend, wait another year. It took a long time for you and I to follow the river back to where it kills. And nature isn't the only murderer to go free. But at least it's got a million tasks for the tongue. So when two mouths come together, they only mean to stand for emptiness. They draw new borders in the smallest districts of the body, like the passing of an electron from hydrogen to form another variation of water. There, along the Hudson, back on the main drag that runs past the quiet rooms of your beloved elder's last madness, someone's granddaughter is guiding a younger boy in twisted school shirt with her fingertips, light on his shoulder. Everywhere but here, a word I can't pronounce begins to sing inside me. It signifies half an absence. Your mouth signifies another. Between the two of us, we are bearing six languages into the future. We share the seventh, which is silence. The century ahead of us will want to know how the landscapes changed in our brief lifetimes. It's simple. We stripped to our ankles once and danced. We cataloged every vibrant thing beside a dying river at dusk. We became whatever we named. We were so sick from suffering. We pressed our lips to everything we could not bless. Thank you very much.